people, here's your governor with a message for you, and you should listen to it because it happened to me.
But discrimination isn't always that obvious. Sometimes more subtle, but in many ways more insidious. An institutionalized discrimination that's hidden behind a smiling face.
Supplemental log, December 12, 2010. I'm going to call Ida Smith at the office of Congressman Meeks to find out what's going on here.
Good morning.
Good morning, Ms. Hart. May I speak to Ida, please?
Please hold on.
Thank you. Oh, 4 minutes. I'm on hold. I must be calling Social Security. And this is the kind of treatment I normally get that I'd be bragging about is so great. Bullshit. Hello, Ida. How you doing?
I'm not sure. How are you?
I'm doing well.
Something's wrong with your voice. What's wrong?
That walking pneumonia I had. No, it never went away. I'm still being taken care of by Aza.
Okay.
Now, Ida, I got a big problem. Ida?
I'm listening.
Why can't you all put on a piece of paper, NYCHA's conducting a formal redlining? Why is my stuff missing? What's going on? The two books I gave you to the White House, I spoke to Kim Fuller this morning. Who has them?
You have them. You took them yourself.
No, I didn't take them.
You did take them. You told me, well, if they're not going to D.C., I need to keep them. And I said, fine.
That's not what we said Friday.
No, we said Friday. I said, if Kim doesn't have them, then you have them. Because I gave her something that she carried back. Hold on a second. Hold on.
Yes, ma'am.
Listen,
Ida. I spoke to her already. I don't want to.
She
said she got one book that I addressed to the Justice Department. I never sent anything to the Justice Department. There were only two books for the White House and the White House only.
Well, then she took it upon herself to give it to the Justice Department because I know that when she was here, I gave her something and I told you that. I remember telling you that.
So she took it upon herself to give it to the Justice Department, Ida? How you say? Ida, these people destroyed my life. These people hurt me.
You have to bear in mind this protocol. Okay. We don't send anything directly to the president. I told you.
I do. I did, and look at what I got. What y'all did didn't get me nothing. You've been watching me for years. You've been watching me for years. You know I'm not crazy, and you know what I got. If it ever gets exposed, everybody's screwed.
I haven't exposed anything.
That's what the problem is. I needed you to.
No, I could not do what I was told I couldn't do.
Oh, you would? Okay.
Okay.
Mommy, you know what? Then I was right about you.
And
I told you
from the jump what was going to happen. I told you that they were not going to read it. And that's why you took the other one.
If I got them, okay. But anyway, the exact same thing are the court papers for my appellate court case, so it's not lost. I just wanted your copy so that I can show that I submitted this, that it was supposed to be for the White House, and it never was sent there to your office, and it was your superior that contained it. That's obstruction of justice.
No, it isn't, because you could have sent it yourself, and you didn't want to.
Because with the evidence that you got, that you read, and you concluded that NYCHA's conducting a form of redlining, only you can say that, not me.
I said I agree. I didn't put words in your mouth. I said I agreed with you. It was a form of it.
Okay.
And I don't say that I said that because I didn't say it.
All right. Then
you did what you did anyway.
Then what it said is that the Office of Congressman Meech agrees with the evidence, which is what we said from the beginning, that from the look of the evidence, not what I said, it's what the evidence says. NYCHA is conducting a form of redlining.
No, we've always agreed to that the evidence speaks for itself.
Right. Well, then somebody's supposed to do something after I lost all this, Ida. After I lost all this, don't you want to help me get my money? That's the only way I'm going to get a pretty woman.
Requisite. And you know that's a fact. And you know that's not what you're about.
Well, guess what? Mother is courting a woman for me, giving me things to take to this woman that's got two kids. She just got a brand new baby. The boy, I met the guy, and I was telling him I'm giving this kid a college scholarship because I pay like $40 a month, and he gets at least a 2-year degree, and all that. And then she tell me. She ain't with, and I mean she gorgeous. I love them kids. But I'm tired of getting a woman through loving their kids.
I hear you.
I've been through that already, well, raising people. Why you think when I get mad, I say all the bad things I say?
Well, you can blame whatever you want, but it's all coming from your mind. So anything you say, I'm not going to believe.
How do I regain all the money, all the time, everything I lost?
Well, what happened to the AquaTube?
AquaTube is right here. I got it out.
Then why aren't you doing it?
I need money from all of my losses in order to kick this off. I need $70,000 just for the radio commercials. I need another $30,000 to give to them down. I need at least $150,000. I spent close to $400 already.
Because you had contracts.
I have a contract which is an allotment contract. I've got to spend all of the advertising dollars in order to generate what I need to make it a contract is something that two people provide.
So you're suggesting that your pursuit of the Ninth Web is going to pay for that?
My pursuit of this cause for black people's rights, that all the black politicians did all everything they could to help the city destroy my life.
I don't believe that.
Yes, I do, Ida.
You're using it as a catch-all.
No, listen to me, Ida. When the office of the congressman got evidence that something as so egregious has occurred, and that the president's office responds to the Justice Department with and the letter showing. Where was I supposed to? I wasn't supposed to know what she sent, when she sent it, how she sent it, what's going on, so that would be consistent.
Let me speak to her, because if she told you she sent it, she sent it.
Okay, then I need a response letter. She was telling me, since my stuff was so garbage and disoriented, they don't respond to that.
Excuse me. They've moved offices twice, and you know what it's like to move your house. It's worse when you're moving an office.
Okay. Guess what? That's why the letter from the VA, I used that as my own excuse not to file litigation on anybody like I was threatening and all that stuff, because we need to get this together, please. But I'm going on vacation. I'm done. After talking to you.
I'm trying to find your white book. If she says she has one, I know you have the other, because I didn't want it here.
Okay, guess what? Now you know. Now I know how important it was. Look, right now,
What it is is that I told you that they weren't going to read it, and you took it. You said, if that's the case, then I need to hold on. I said, fine. And then something else happened, and you needed it anyway.
Right now?
You don't remember that?
No, ma'am. But that's okay. I got the duplicate in the court moving papers in appellate division. It's going to cost $300 to get it. That's all. Nothing else. but I just needed that one because since y'all had it, I wanted to show that I did my due diligence to bring this forward. I got a book coming out. I got to prove everything I say.
Well, you have enough documentation to prove everything you say. I've always told you that.
All right, now I'm selling that story. But then, now, what about this whole situation with it goes back all the way to the Attorney General, which is now the governor-elect, unleashing NYCHA and untying their hands with no oversight for them to write policies that is eliminating people because of the Clinton administration welfare elimination program. This is crazy. This can get me killed. The things I'm saying. And the evidence points to it. What do you want me to do now? Get out with my life. That's what I gotta do.
Get on, not out.
Oh, get on with my life. Well, yeah. Well, I don't know. I think I'm gonna go hit on this young girl half my age with two kids and a brand new born baby. As a matter of fact, you can see the baby on the internet now. That's my new show. And Kim told me to stop. I can't let them get away with this. All right, let me go get me a woman. Listen, I got a story for you. This is the story. I'm going to Florida to meet up with the Cuban mermaid colony who meet every 10 years to mate. But what they do first is they're seven sisters from the seven seas that end up meeting up on Cuba Island to rest, go to Haiti to eat, and then beach themselves and turn into regular women on Miami Beach, and the guy that's lucky enough to be standing there as a homeless guy on the beach gets to mate with the seven sisters. But the irony is, this is your Floyd Flake Garage, your charity case no more, and he had it as a partner with Congressman Meeks, and they owe millions of dollars. Bye. Hi there. Supplemental log. December 12, 2010. I'm about to call Washington, D.C. to talk to Kim Ford to find out what happened to the bodies of evidence that I gave to the congressman's office, to Ida Smith, that was taken by Kim Ford to D.C., was never recorded. It's been getting contained. These are part of my allegations of obstruction of justice. Let's listen. Yes, Congressman Meek's office? Yes, Mass Speaker Kim Fuller, please.
Yes, no.
Okay.
Do you mind calling her back in about 20 minutes?
Yeah, what's your name?
Ashley.
Ashley, hi Ashley. My name is Philip Dreis. She picked up two books from Ida Smith some time ago that was supposed to go to the White House. That nobody seems to know where they are to give it back to me because y'all didn't send it to the White House. I never got a letter saying that y'all got it. And I got a letter from the Justice Department, and for 6 months your office has been stealing my stuff or not giving me my stuff, and nobody's talking and everybody saying I'm crazy, all kinds of stuff, Ashley. I need some help here, okay? So let me give you my number. Ask him to call me, call Ida Smith, because y'all got to fix this problem. Or, I don't know, I guess, you know, the Justice Department's going to have to get involved and find out who has been taking evidence from the congressman's office, whether there was a burglary, something happened, and we have evidence that's missing. I need to get that back so I can send it to the White House with the Justice Department referral number, and your office has had it for over a year. You didn't do nothing with it, and you ain't responsible. This ain't you, baby. Whoever your bosses are, with Sophia King out because she's pregnant, she's the one that tried to say I was some kind of threat to the congressman, because I said I was in the special forces and I want to fight for your country. And then she, you know, doing all kinds of stuff to try to make me look and sound crazy. Somebody even told me when I played Lauren Sterling, yeah, I'm calling, oh, you ain't big enough, blah. Oh, Jice, he's crazy. That can kill my life. Okay, please tell her, it's very important. Let me give you my number. Okay, Ashley? My number is 347-685-2860. I just need my stuff back, get it out of your hands, and I'll leave you all alone. I don't want no problems. I ain't no threat to nobody. My life's been destroyed, and somebody, and it's been other people. Y'all didn't do that. So that's what I'm saying. Just let me get my stuff, and let me take it to the Justice Department and show them what New York City Housing Authority did. Y'all don't want to get involved? You know, whatever. You know, y'all had evidence for years. Y'all, man, but y'all offices, people in your office have been saying bad, bad things about me, and I'm not crazy. I'm a great guy. I don't get it. You get my point? Okay, thank you, Ashley. You got my number? Could you, you want my number again?
347-685-2860.
I thank you so very much. Please tell her it's urgent. I can't wait. Too long. This has been taking too long. 5 years out of my life. 3.5 years with your office. And Ida Smith, they keep sending me. I got a mama, but I came to your offices to give evidence. I didn't come to make friends, turn black because I'm from Haiti and I need to be African American. I don't need nothing but justice. You got evidence that's criminal behavior, diverting of funds, eliminating people that are remaining family members in public housing, all kinds of stuff, crimes like that. I'm a competent investigator. I really got a doctorate's degree, an associate's, a bachelor's, a master's, and I'm really related to 3 presidents of my country. I don't want to be no poor black ghetto Negro and I come to y'all sucking up to y'all like your gods. I mean, your bosses, that is. You get my point?
Yeah.
Thank you, Ashley.
Okay.
I appreciate you, baby. Thank you. Okay, bye-bye.
What?
What? What? I'm going to get Ida Smith like that next. Watch me. Bye-bye. This is Washington, D.C. calling. Damn, I missed the call. Let me call him right back. Yeah. It should be Kim Fuller. Hello? Hello? I gotta call him back and get this on camera.
You have reached an occupancy number at the U.S. House of Representatives. G3B.
You see this? This is a number that just called me. Okay? Watch this. Now, I'm going to call Washington, D.C. I'm going to call the congressman's office, find out what's going on here. This is crazy. See? If I didn't have this, no one would believe me. Okay? Meeks, D.C. Meeks, D.C. Contact. Meeks, D.C. Meeks, D.C. I'm low on battery power. I don't want this to die on me. Let's put it on speakerphone. Yeah, is this Ashley?
Yes.
Hi, Ashley. Somebody just called me from D.C. and I called back the number and it said it was a non-working number.
Okay, hold on a second.
For Kim Fuller?
Mr. Joyce?
Yes, Ms. Fuller?
Yes, it's Kim.
Hi,
from
Kim.
How are you?
I'm fine. The two bodies of evidence that was supposed to go to the White House.
I don't know where the other one was, but I took one book and I sent it to the Justice Department. And when the letter said, please see the attach from a constituent in our district.
But I need a copy of that letter, who you sent it to, and I need the other book.
Well, I don't know where it is, because I got one book, Mr. Dry.
I understand. I'm not blaming you. But, Kim, okay. Don't you see this looks really bad?
You blame me, though, because you keep sending emails that are offensive, that talk about the staff in a derogatory way, and that's not...
Look, but my dear, what your staff, listen... It was your young lady, when I said I was Dawn Sterling, said I was crazy. You're the one's been talking bad about me behind my back. And I've got to find a way of she did say it to me.
Yes, and she should not have said that. But then
she should not have said that, okay, but then I'm telling you, you can't blame it all on me.
And it's right now 7:40.
As far as Mayor Bloomberg is concerned, the New York Senate, the Congressional Committee is all full of shit. Because me and this man have legitimate evidence and what have you. And I have sued PD and fucking won. But this is bullshit, goddammit. This is what the fuck it is, you know, goddammit. And, you know, in the righteousness through God that sent his only begotten son down here. Fuck with his denomination, his abomination of making this motherfucker and then turning his goddamn back on it is fucking bullshit. Why the hell did his only son begot son have to come down here and fuck with this and
now,
be tortured
by
goddamn fucking Jews?
Before we run out of time, Robert, now, when I gave you that fly, you saw your mother's name on it, you called her.
Yes, I did.
And then when you talked to her and you asked her, was I the guy that supposed to put the death threat or anything crazy like that?
No, you were not. No, Ma denied that. It was not Dr. Philip Dreis.
It was somebody else.
Fuck,
I have nothing to do with anything
state,
like
who
that.
Who had state police and a local 113th cop who held my hand one night. I was going to alcohol withdrawal. Another nice-looking balding cop. Yeah. I talked about like dogs, that precinct. But yeah, they did ruin my fucking life along with that stink fucking cunt hoe, Chantel Hassad Dubois. And she is full of shit. You know?
Now, when you spoke to her, did she knew about this case about New York City Housing Authority and all that nonsense with me?
She knew about it. She knew about it 100%, but her aides were handling the case, at which point they did not let my mother in on what's happening.
And now
she's trapped. They intercepted this man's legitimate interfucking-mation through aid, you know, like all politicians go. Not all politicians get their mails read and received by aides and do whatever the fuck they want with it. God damn it. Kiss my fucking ass.
Bruh, we done here, man.
Is that Section 8? If you give us a relatively brief answer on this going forward.
Oh, it's absolutely solid at this point. This was, for perfect storm kinds of reasons, we were in this financial crisis. The storm has passed. We are now managing within resources that are available to us and predicted for the near future. And so at this point, the resolution that of these families that are now being ported over to HPD has now resolved the issue short and, I believe, long term as well.
Okay, then we have the other development, which was much ballyhooed, which is this plan by which the Housing Authority, to some degree, passes title almost to the projects, to its real estate,
mm-hmm.
to effectively a, quote, nonprofit, which then is able to receive funds from the federal government that it otherwise could not receive, essentially for capital improvements. Is that the gist of it?
And ongoing operational dollars. Yes, it's the gist.
And that's significant. Tell our viewers the significance of that.
Oh, it's very significant. Since the mid-90s, these properties that were built by the benevolence of the city and the state look and are inhabited by public housing folks, you really can't tell the federally funded ones from the ones that were built by the city or the state. However, the properties built by the city and state were not receiving any dollars to operate or to be fixed up. What was going on was that for years and years, NYCHA was using dollars they were getting.
NYCHA being New York City Housing Authority.
Was using dollars they were getting from the federal government, and bleeding it away from where the properties were given the money to help support the operations of these other properties that weren't getting any dollars. And so consequently, everything was going down. The properties that were being given the money designated to weren't being given the full dollar value. And these properties were being given 50 cents on the dollar as well. This particular move is one in which we were able to get funding for these properties for the first time in many, many years, so that we can actually bring on caretakers, bring on plumbers and carpenters and such to bring up the quality of life at the sites, and to have an ongoing predictable stream of dollars moving into the future.
And is that earmarked in ways that you can't put it to other uses, meaning that it is for capital improvements and maintenance?
Absolutely. And I think it's part of the earmarking also is built into the deal, the legal structure of our deal, that they will remain available and only available for low-income New Yorkers forever.
Before we get into some of the controversies relating to that, I know you're relatively new on the job here, but could you give me a percentage, as we speak, of elevators that are working in New York City Public Housing Authority projects?
Well, as of last night,
okay.
I think there right. were...
I'll take that.
Out of the 2,800 elevators that are within our portfolio, which is probably more elevators than there are in cities like Cincinnati or places, just to put things in perspective, I think there were two elevators that were out last night. The elevator crisis...
Now, that sounds like a pretty unusually low number. I've been around this town for a long time, and the saga of public housing tenants and elevators has been goes back almost to biblical times.
Yeah, I think what we have been really blessed with is remarkable technicians that are working with us right now, a real commitment to preventive maintenance, and a real commitment to modernization. A lot of these elevators were just past their useful life. And I think we're not there yet by any stretch of the imagination, but we have a modernization program in place that's looking to replace the antiquated elevators. But as importantly, more importantly, we have a system in place in which we're oiling and tweaking and doing all the things on the front end to avoid the downtime that happens on the back end. Unfortunately, though, despite our best efforts, vandalism is the real thing we have no control over, and that's the
you
one
say
thing.
No control over. Why? Briefly, again, we want to cover a lot of territory, but that seems to be passing the buck, saying you have no control over vandalism on your own properties.
Well, I wish I could say it was differently. Honestly, David, it's a situation where someone with malintent would walk into an elevator at any given time, even at this moment, and there is just not enough police officers or cameras or systems in place for stopping someone from doing bad things in the elevator that would cause the elevator to shut down.
You still have the power, do you know, to evict tenants, for example, whose children are doing joyriding, what they call elevator surfing, jumping from the top of one elevator to the top of the other one while they're moving, and other kinds of vandalism?
Absolutely. That's the one thing we do have, is the lease agreement as the major enforcement tool. And we've also welded shut the passageways through the cab to the top, so we've really decreased the whole elevator surfing down to a minimum. But to your point, that is the strongest tool the Housing Authority has to impact the habits of our of those that want to do wrong. Mm-hmm. And we make it really clear to the parents that your housing is in jeopardy if your children do vandalism or if they do things that, that disrupt the quiet enjoyment for the neighbors.
This is Dr. Philip Edward Dreis, personal log. I found this video on the internet, and it helps explain the multiple ways that HUD, HPD, New York City Housing Authority, are in collusion to eliminate the rent roll in public housing converted to Section 8, which is a methodology in the 21 developments I spoke about in the World Appellate Court and the prosecution of those state senators, Shirley Huntley and Malcolm Smith, being a bunch of traitors to the people in public housing. This is another way of getting people out of public housing. Now watch this. It's got 807 hits already since yesterday. Just got put on. Watch what this guy says on how New York City Housing Authority takes apartments out of the rent roll, which is another form of redlining, separate from the remaining family member issue. But still, now you can see why the guy that's going for governor, Mr. Cuomo, don't want to have anything to do with this, because when you backtrack or you reconstitute this whole scheme, it goes back to the Clinton administration, who wanted to eliminate welfare. Okay? And that means you eliminate people out of public housing through a revolving door policy that the Bloomberg administration picked up. And the rest is history. But let's concentrate on what this says. Watch this.
That calls for them transitioning 8,400.
Who's this guy?
Of their
that's the guy that's the blowing the whistle.
All of the state-funded NYCHA buildings, if you add up the amount of units and all
on New York City and New York State, how they got robbed for a half a billion dollars of property.
Of those buildings. The ones that affect Harlem.
I'm paying $7,000.
Manhattanville.
Yep.
Frederick Samuels.
That's property taxes.
And Drew Hamilton. When you look at the details of the plan, let's say that you move out of the building altogether for whatever reason. That has nothing to do with this program. That building, that apartment is going to turn into a Section 8 apartment. If you sign for the vouchers, now this goes beyond, you know, being on the waiting list for to try to get the voucher or even filling out the application. Once they say, okay, we will give you this Section 8 voucher, but once you sign that contract for the voucher, you transition that apartment into the Section 8 program. This special program is not the same type of Section 8. They have different nuances that, you know, are different than the normal Section 8. One of the things that they have to lure you in, and I think this is like to lure you in, is that they're waiving the background check, the criminal background check, and the income verification for 6 months. Now you know that you've never heard of that before, you know? So obviously we're trying to get everybody, you know, to take this so they can transition these apartments. But now when it is time for them to do the income verification and the background check, and you don't qualify, guess what? You're out. Okay? You're going to lose your subsidy, and you can't, it doesn't go back to being in the NYCHA
rent roll,
you know, apartment pool. It's a Section 8 apartment. So you
rent roll fraud.
Period. That's another thing. Once you sign the voucher, you can't change your mind. You can't, like, 2 weeks later say, okay, never mind, I don't want to do this. You know? It's a done deal. Now, there'll be all kinds of ways. These are the various scenarios that people need to realize. That, let's say, for example, you sign for the voucher. Okay? Let's just say now, under Section 8, that your household size is too small for the apartment that you're living in. Okay? So they may want to downsize you. Not may, they will. If they can't find an apartment in that particular development where you come out of, you're not going into one of the other 20 available apartments if they have any. You're going to go into a federal building okay? Now, who do they bring in aside from the people living there in these developments? And these people come from a special list. HUD has a special list that I'm sure they're going to share with NYSA. They have the complete profile of who these people are, okay? They've already been, you know, from reliable sources, they've been showing the apartments already to potential tenants. And none of them look like, really, they're, put it this way, they're different. They're everything but African-American so far. I would say don't sign the voucher. There are people out there that are now becoming, they're getting up to speed on what's happening with this plan. So they'll have all the information, and they really need to know what they're getting into. You know, so it's going to look good, you know, because they're making it look really good, all right? But don't go by what Mike is presenting to you. That's what I'm saying. Because when, you know, when can you really truly trust what's happening with Harlem, period, you know, with the 125th Street rezoning, the Columbia expansion plan, and our local government failed us. So can we really trust the agencies that are headed by Bloomberg appointees? The answer is no. So
Robert Jackson, Melissa Benito.
Don't sign the voucher. Really, know what this program is really all about. Know it very well. And then if it benefits you, okay, you know, it could, there's a possibility it could benefit some people, then go ahead and, and sign for it.
But not likely.
I'm saying that it's not going to really benefit the majority of the tenants. Well, they can contact me at the provided email.
Right.
And also...
Preserve Harlem's Legacy at yahoo.com.
Groups like Maribel Sisters,
212-234-3002.
Nellie Bailey at the Harlem Tenants Council. There's some other on that list. But then the Manhattanville Tenants Association, okay, they're going to be up to speed. The Drew Hamilton Tenants Association, they're going to be up to speed. I can't speak offhand just yet about Frederick Sandler, but I know Drew Hamilton Tenants Association, they're going to be up to speed on this, Manhattanville, and we're trying to now, you know, get this message out to the other developments in the other boroughs.
backstabbing.
Speaker number four, Philip Price, please come forward.
Chairman, I'd like to thank you and I congratulate you.
Thank you.
You are the most articulate and the most charming chairman of the four chairmen that I've known. Lady, isn't he a good-looking guy? Just a good-looking guy. Okay? Now, we're going to be real nice to Mr. Rhea.
Did my mother pay you to say that?
No. This guy did, the housing whistleblower.
Okay, all right.
I'm that guy.
All right.
Mr. Chairman, I spoke to Constance Robitaille. This retaliation against me to destroy my life, can it please stop? I'm a remaining family member. Right now, I've been beating up Byron Metakakis in Supreme Court so bad, this is for you. I just beat him up that
fast. Yeah, okay. So. Okay, you should move to the next one.
Mr. Chairman, I have 1 minute and 40 seconds. Three things. Number one, the retaliation against the whistleblower. If an old lady is embezzled by an employee out of $20,858, Ricardo Elias Morales calls my boss, who I work for at a law firm, and tell me to tell them to leave alone. I left them alone, but you don't leave the old lady in your apartment with the gas stove on for 4 hours, and then you orchestrate a retaliation scheme against me with a containment apparatus that destroyed my life, cost my business over $4.5 million, $100,000 for antiques taken out of my home. I'm a Haitian French Orthodox Roman Catholic. I leave people alone. I don't bother anybody, but the kind of compassion that it takes to see what I'm seeing is just humane. It's nothing special. Another thing, criminal neglect. I don't understand this. You mean to tell me you got two lawyers in two different courts and both of them have a different story about an supposed exclusive senior development that is not? Another one. When you deceive the judges, you deceive the courts, and I bring that to you. The Veterans Administration asked Congress to speak to call in state and federal law enforcement. Ida Smith says, you even got a call recently about May Keys, where they said NYCHA is conducting a form of redlining. Those 21 developments, I believe, were part of the Davis versus NYCHA, that it was found that NYCHA was conducting a form of redlining. Are we still on the same page here? And I'm done.
Mr. Price, we'll have somebody come over and speak to you. Okay, specific to your concerns. Speaker number five, Carmen Quinones.
Hi, how are you?
Mike's coming.
But I am from Douglas Houses. First, I want to tell you, welcome.
Thank you.
I'm sorry that you're getting beat up, but NYCHA has done so much to people that we don't know who to believe anymore, which is sad. I want to tell you that, though, Gloria, hi, because you have always been very helpful to me. And Margarita Lopez, always there, presente. But what I want to tell you is that there are so many things wrong that people don't want to believe anything. Mm-hmm. That's where we're at here. I think that your presentation, beautiful. But even to get here, I couldn't even get down because my elevator was broke. So I had to come down 15 steps, get on the train, and come to see you, baby.
Okay. All right. So, listen, go ahead. I'm sorry.
After my 2 minutes, you can tell me whatever you want.
I thought it was about elevator.
My concern is that we have a lot of seniors in our development. A lot. We also have a lot of youth. They don't know what to do. They have nothing to do, so they're lottering. They're hanging. Our seniors are scared to come out. They're scared to come out. These developments have become hazardous. Your elevators, I am so tired of them coming and putting a Band-Aid on that elevator and that Band-Aid falling off in 2 seconds. So I understand where you're going, and I know that we need the money because we too are underfunded in our development. We need more maintenance workers, and I hear you. All I'm just asking you is to bear with them, bear with everybody here, because everybody is not going to be nice. But I just want you to know that I'm here for you. We're here for you.
Thank you.
All right?
Absolutely. So, I, first of all, thank you.
At the New York City Housing Authority, we have sign language interpreters for the hearing impaired on the stage and Spanish, Russian, and Chinese translators for those that need it in the audience. Will the interpreters please come to the microphone to identify yourselves?
Tenemos servicios de interpretación en español. Si necesitan, por favor, de salir al lobby para recibir el equipo de audio. Muchas gracias.
Добрый вечер. Переводчик русского языка Ирина. Пожалуйста, если у вас есть какие-то вопросы, обращайтесь в правую часть нашего зала.
Remington Low, Chinese interpreter, Lo Ming Dong, 翻译 广东话.
The purpose of this town hall meeting is to share with you the final components of the New York City Housing Authority Mixed Finance Modernization Plan to secure ongoing federal funding for the long-term capital and operating needs of the 21 city and state-built developments. Federalization, or the Mixed Finance Modernization Plan, will provide for certain immediate and necessary rehabilitation work at these 21 developments. It will also ensure additional dedicated funds for all 334 NYCHA developments. That means more money to pay for the things that your development needs to keep the buildings operating safely and soundly. The purpose of the town hall meeting tonight is for you to hear how the efforts will improve your development and preserve public housing for the future. Tonight, we will have the following NYCHA representatives here on the dais to hear and answer your questions. They are NYCHA Chairman John B. Rea, Vice Chairman Earl Andrews Jr., Commissioner Margarita Lopez, General Manager Michael P. Kelly, and Deputy General Manager for Operations Gloria Finkelman. We hope that as many people as possible will have an opportunity to provide comments this evening. So before we begin, let's go over the following ground rules. If you wish to speak, first you must fill out a speaker's slip. They are available in the entrance area at the table marked speaker sign-in. Please line up with each of the microphones in the center aisles and wait your turn to speak. Each speaker is allowed 3 minutes to speak. On the stage, you will see a timer with 3 lights. When you begin to speak, the green light will be on and the timer will begin to count down. When the yellow light is lit, it means that you should start to conclude your remarks. When the red light is turned on, your 3 minutes to provide comments are over. A table has been set up outside so the written comments may also be submitted. Numbered speaker slips are non-transferable, and you are not present or do not wish to speak with your name and number is called, you will forfeit the opportunity to speak. The hearing is being recorded and transcribed by a stenographer. So please speak only from the microphone in the aisles and identify yourself and your development or affiliation. Remember, we are here to discuss the mixed finance modernization plan. Any personal comments on criticism of or oral attacks on NYCHA personnel, resident representatives, and public attendees, or any demeaning, discriminatory, or ethnic slurs or vulgar language will not be tolerated. I, as the moderator and this evening's meeting, reserve the right to immediately move on to the next speaker online if any comments are deemed inappropriate. The moderator on the stage is in charge of the town hall. Please be considerate of your neighbors and obey the moderator's directions. We are here to consider issues that are of concern to everyone, not issues that concern only a single resident or individual. If you have an issue that concerns only you or your apartment, we have tables set up outside specifically for those purposes. You may find out a resident response form at the table. You may fill out a resident response form at the table marked resident complaints. The passing out materials, photo taking, video recording are not allowed in the auditorium. However, a general information station is available outside where leaflets and flyers may be displayed. Resource tables have been set up outside with information so that at the end of the meeting, you can pick up information that may be interest to you on resident employment services, fair housing, social services, citywide programs, health providers, and information on the census. With that being said, let me introduce John B. Rea, Chairman of the New York City Housing Authority.
Hello, everyone. It's great to be here this evening, and I appreciate everybody taking time out of your schedules to join us. And it's really good to be up here on the stage with my fellow leadership team and Commissioner Lopez and Vice Chairman Andrews, General Manager Kelly, who many of you have had the chance to meet already, and Deputy General Manager Gloria Finkelman. We are pretty excited about the opportunity that's presented itself related to the federalization opportunity. I think I originally started to communicate with many of the leadership, tenant leaders in November about the possibility of making federalization a reality. This is a topic that has been discussed for quite some time, for the better part of a decade, on how to ensure that these 21 city and state developments that are just like every other NYCHA development around the city, filled with wonderful tenants who make New York City the wonderful place it is, but who didn't seem to get the same fair shake that the rest of the developments were getting in terms of the support that they deserve for both capital improvements as well as ongoing operating maintenance and support to ensure that they'll be around for another 75 years. And a lot of people worked hard to try various ways to make the federalization a possibility. And as those of you who've been through the wars know, that was everything from judicial relief to try and get the courts to attach some form of support to the development, to legislatively in Washington, and then now through this transactional approach. And the other, despite a lot of hard work on the parts of many, and particularly Senator Chuck Schumer and Congresswoman Velasquez, who've been working on this for more than a decade, please. They deserve a round of applause, they absolutely do. But they actually were extremely instrumental into getting us to where we are today. If it weren't for the two of them, not only would we not have built the kind of momentum around this federalization effort, but the money that's been put into the budget in Washington to support the federalization would not have been a reality. So I know so many people have worked hard, and this morning I was with many of your leaders from the Citywide Council of Presidents, including Reginald Bowman, and he really gave some background here on how hard people have worked for a long time to try and make this federalization a reality. So I'm excited tonight because we're here to say that we will have federalization for these 21 city and state developments. Not just that we are proposing it and we're pursuing it, but that it is actually a reality. This morning we had a press conference in which the mayor, along with Senator Schumer and Congresswoman Velasquez and the governor, Assemblyman Lopez and Speaker Silver, and in the Senate, leadership Sampson and Daniel Squadron, we were all there together to announce what is really a historic day in terms of getting what will amount to, just to put it in perspective, the 20,000 plus units in the 21 city and state developments with over 40,000 residents would be the third largest housing authority in the country on a standalone basis. I want to repeat that. It would be the third largest housing authority if it was a housing authority on its own. The New York, then Chicago, and then this entity. So it's very important that we recognize and we take a minute and reflect on why it's been such a challenge to get these units federalized and to get funding for them, and it's because it requires a substantial amount of money on an annual basis to be put into the appropriations budget in Washington to support them. And given that it benefits New York and not any other states, that's a tough thing to get through a legislative process in Washington. And so we owe a lot to those of you who fought really hard for it and to those who were able to get appropriation funding for it. And so we celebrated or announced this morning that we were doing this, and the whole purpose of it is to ensure that public housing is preserved in New York City. Without preserving these 20,000 units, it runs the risk of not being able to preserve all of public housing in New York. And there are obvious reasons for that. First and foremost, having to drain money away from other developments to support the 21 city and state developments just means that the entire public housing portfolio within New York is not receiving the resources it needs to be preserved. And as I've said from the day that I was lucky enough to be appointed by the mayor, the number one risk to public housing in New York is not that people don't believe that it has value, it's that if we don't get enough money to continue to maintain the buildings, then ultimately the preservation is at risk because the buildings aren't being maintained. And we've seen that happen in other places in the country, throughout the country. So this is about preservation first and foremost. And I said that this morning. It's about ensuring that the families who live in these 20,000 plus units can maintain their residency and be proud of the place that they live in, because it's getting the investments and the resources in terms of ongoing maintenance and staffing that it needs. It's about innovation, because we had to find a way out of the ordinary, traditional way to ensure that there was support for these buildings from a financial standpoint and to raise the money that is going to go immediately into investing in these buildings today. And that's the Mixed Financing Modernization Program, in which we had to put both public dollars with private dollars in order to invest in the rehabilitation work. And it's about collaboration. There are a lot of people, as I said, who really should deserve all the credit for being able to get the federalization over the finish line. In addition to the elected officials, you know, a lot of advocates, housing advocates, have been supportive of this, came into the process early to understand and ensure that residents' rights would be protected. And also, there are a lot of partners across the city. The state had to pass legislation in order to facilitate this. After the state passed the legislation, the governor had to sign it. We also needed a lot of help from our partners in city government. HDC, the Housing Development Corporation, is helping us issue the financing, as well as housing preservation and development, and then also the private sector, Citibank, City Community Capital, that's putting up not only $200 million of tax credit equity into the transaction, but is also providing other support for the credit. So a lot of people, a lot of entities had to collaborate to make this happen, not the least of which is the NYCHA team that's worked really hard to make sure that this happened. And this morning, to emphasize how important this was, the Secretary of HUD, Sean Donovan, was here in New York to announce this and to sign the documents to make this a reality. And he was here basically representing President Obama, and he was here to discuss why this has been so important to invest in public housing in this administration in Washington, and that given that President Obama got to start organizing in public housing in Chicago, one of his first commitments was to ensure that public housing is preserved across the country, and to demonstrate that by actually speaking with the most powerful way he can, which is to ensure that there's money available and that he put the best person in the job to in HUD, in Sean Donovan, to ensure that we have the kind of support and understanding in Washington that New Yorkers need, and particularly residents of public housing. So a lot of people at the highest levels of this country are basically supporting this effort. And when things like this happen, it's worth us taking a minute to note that, you know, it's only because of the hard work of so many of the 400,000 people who live in public housing demanding and advocating for support that gets us to this point. And I think, you know, I'm not here to preach, but I am here to kind of give credit where it's due. And it's really due to each and every one of you in this room and the members of public housing who have fought this long battle for quite some time. It's interesting that Reggie Bowman said something earlier today at the press conference. He said it was a year ago, about a year ago today, which was before I arrived, that a similar group was organized or gathered at Rutgers Houses, where the press conference was this morning, and which is one of the developments that's going to benefit from the federalization. And he mentioned that the group was organized to go down to Washington and demand additional resources to support NYCHA and public housing in New York. And it's great to be able to stand here a year later and to say that your voices were heard. So with that, I want to get into the specific slides and talk about what it means and what it doesn't mean. But what it certainly means is that your voices have been heard and your leadership is working hard to try to make a difference in your daily lives. So I'm going to need you to turn this on. It's gone off.
Andy Nagy.
I see a gentleman with his hand up. Can you just hold your question? We're going to get the questions in a little bit. So we'll. Thanks. So I know I met with many of you in various forums to discuss this throughout the process. We started this effort back in the late summer to try to understand whether or not the stimulus legislation that was passed by President Obama created an opportunity for us to get the 21 city and state developments federalized. So we started this work at the very early stages just to understand whether or not legally there was an opportunity to use the stimulus funding to facilitate the federalization effort. And so we started this conversation then, and since that time there's been a series of meetings with various interested parties, elected tenant leadership, as well as tenant with the residents of the affected developments, and we had a larger town hall meeting where all of NYCHA was invited to understand what we were proposing. So I know for many of you, this won't be the first time you've seen this information, and I'm going to try to go through it quickly so we can get to the questions that are on your mind. But as I said, it's the stimulus legislation, the Recovery Act, that provided a one-time exception that would allow NYCHA to get the city and state developments into the HUD funding formula. And the reason is there's a limitation on adding new public housing to the funding formula. It's called the Faircloth Amendment, and it prohibits housing authorities from adding new units to the funding formula, and therefore NYCHA could not take the units in the 21 city and state developments and add them into the federal funding formula. But the stimulus legislation basically said money could be spent to preserve, rehabilitate, and acquire new housing, and that the limitations that the Faircloth Amendment had actually wouldn't apply. And so that's the most important element of this, is that President Obama's and the Congress's Stimulus Act provided a one-time opportunity for the federalization to take place. But it also said that the stimulus dollars had to be spent, obligated, committed on the same timelines that the rest of the stimulus money had to be spent, which means we had to have it fully obligated, committed in contracts by March 17th of this year, so a couple of days from now, Wednesday, and then it has to all be spent by March of 2012. So we have 2 years in order to do all of the rehabilitation work. And so that put us under a very tight timeline in order to get the federalization approved before March 17th. If we didn't get this done by Wednesday, then we would have lost the one-time opportunity and it wasn't coming back. So we were under very, very tight deadlines. It also said that there need to be a minimum of at least $2,000 spent on average per apartment
in order for it to qualify as substantial rehabilitation work, as they define rehab work. As we'll go through, we worked really hard with HUD to make sure that they didn't mean we literally had to spend $2,000 in each apartment, because if we did, there's just no way we could get this work done in 2 years. We would have to, you know, go into people's apartments, in some cases ask people to, you know, move out. We knew that that was not logistically possible in the 2 year time frame. And so we were able to get HUD to agree that as long as we spent $2,000 on average, when you divided the number of apartments into the buildings, and we spent, you know, the money on the buildings, that would qualify as $2,000 per apartment. So if there's 1,000 units in a development and we have to do 2,000 per apartment, we have to spend $2 million on that development in order for it to qualify. So we immediately decided to focus on things that would not ask you or require you to move out of your apartment, but there would be things that everyone would benefit from, like elevators, like roof jobs, like brickwork, like plumbing and heating systems that obviously we could get the work done on the appropriate timeline. And then lastly, that all of the units, in order to be accepted into the portfolio and to be funded, would have to meet HUD's minimum physical condition standards. And that meant, that's basically how we made a decision on what work we were going to do at what buildings, because as you all know, there's a FAS scoring process that tells us, you know, what at those buildings need to be done in order to receive a passing grade. And so because we had recently done the FAS work, we were able to go building by building and understand what work needed to be done in order to get them up to acceptable standards to be part of the federal portfolio. So those were the requirements that we had to meet. Obviously, all very challenging to make them all mesh together. We set some basic requirements from the beginning. When we looked at this, we said it's very important that we not do anything that actually jeopardizes the status of tenants, or that in any way jeopardizes the long-term status of these buildings as low-income, affordable public housing. And so we set out a couple of requirements for ourselves in order to pursue this as a reasonable plan. The first one is that that your rights needed to be protected. We wanted to make sure that no one was relocated as part of this process, and that families would continue to benefit as public housing residents with all the protections that they are used to, whether that be rent schedules or other protections in terms of your tenancy. Secondly, we needed to know that the private money that we would bring into and the private partners who would participate in this process would be committed to public housing as you all know it, and not ask us to convert it into something different, and to recognize that what we needed was capital from them and their commitment to preservation. And so we went out to three different banking institutions, and ultimately, as you'll hear, we settled on City Community Capital, both because of how aggressive they were with respect to the funding sources that they would provide us on terms that were favorable to NYCHA, but also on a fundamental commitment to New York City and a fundamental commitment to maintaining these units as low-income, affordable housing. We also said that NYCHA had to remain the operating entity responsible for maintaining these developments on a day-to-day basis, so that from a resident's perspective, nothing changes. The people that you're used to working with in your development, the kind of expectations that you have in terms of knowing who to deal with wouldn't change, and it wouldn't be some new private company coming in. And so we wanted to make sure that that was one of the requirements and that it was seamless to each of you. And then lastly, that all of the workers be protected. You know, obviously, NYCHA has almost 12,000 employees that basically show up every day and work hard to ensure that public housing is preserved in New York City, and is very important to me and to everyone on this team, and to, you know, our partners in the unions, that they continue to be long-term responsible for doing the important work that they do. I'm happy to say that all of these requirements have met, and when we get into the Q&A, and as I go through the rest of the presentation, we can discuss that more. The transaction has been basically structured in two portfolios. We had to create a new entity that would own the buildings in order for us to be able to put public money together with private money, and that's why it's called a mixed financing. HUD requires us to take not just the stimulus money that they provided to us, but also that we would take that stimulus money and put it together with other private dollars in the form of a mixed financing transaction in order for it to be eligible for federalization. And so we had to meet that that requirement. And so we had to create new entities in order to own these buildings. So NYCHA is actually selling the buildings into this new entity. We're maintaining ownership of the land outright, and then we created limited partnerships in which the buildings will be acquired by the limited partnership, in which, as I said, NYCHA is the managing partner of the partnership and responsible for operating the developments going forward. Two partnerships. One partnership is a partnership that has the benefits of tax credits in it, and another partnership that didn't require tax credits, and that just has to do with the amount of investment that was required in the different portfolios. The buildings, as I said, will be sold to these partnerships, not the land. The land will basically remain in NYCHA's direct control, and we'll lease the land to the partnerships that own the buildings, so that by definition, the buildings have the right to operate on the land that they sit. But it's protection for you, it's protection for NYCHA, that we own the land outright, and it's just one more protection in the deal to ensure that the Public Housing Authority is the owner and controlling agent of these entities. Secondly, that we will put $250 million of money immediately to improve these buildings. You will begin to see that work commence in the next few weeks with sidewalk sheds going up and other activity mobilizing at your developments to begin the work over the months to come. And we estimate that $212 million of that money is coming directly from Citigroup, City Community Capital, as part of their investment in these developments. And then lastly, we needed to ensure that NYCHA long-term had the right to buy these buildings back at the end of the partnership period, so that once the city received its tax benefits for investing in these buildings, we could dissolve the partnership, reacquire the buildings outright, and that we had that right and that no one else could come in and buy the buildings from us. And so that is part of the development of the agreement as well. Where are we? I kind of took you through a little bit of that already. We got local at the state level. The governor signed the bill into law, which allowed us to transfer these buildings into the partnership. The State Division of Housing and Community Renewal, which had to approve it, had to look at the transaction and the structure, and had to look at the implication on residents and whether or not it was going to continue to preserve these as public low-income housing. It had to look at all of the elements of this deal and give its blessing that what NYCHA was proposing was indeed going to do that. And so the Department of Housing and Community Renewal at the state level has signed off on this, ensuring that it does all of the things that it is intended to do. And you should know that the legislation that was passed in Albany, also had a lot of protections in there, explicit language to ensure, again, that these buildings are preserved as low-income housing for the next 75 years and beyond. And HUD today, as I said, signed off on the ACC contract, which allows the buildings to be federalized and for many of the units to receive its own dedicated funding. Where do we end up? We strongly believe we end up with one NYCHA, 334 developments that are federal public housing developments in New York City, no longer 313 of them that are public housing, federal public housing, and 21 that are city and state. All 334 are federal public housing with all of the protections that that affords its residents. Additionally, we believe that we will be able to modernize your developments with additional money that we wouldn't have received if we hadn't pursued this mixed financing transaction. In addition to the $108 million that's coming in from the stimulus money, we're raising another $303 million that's going to go to these developments, and that will not only do the capital work that I'm telling you about here today, but also that will fund reserves and other operating costs that will ensure that your developments are well maintained going forward. So it's about modernizing, it's about preserving, and ultimately it's about maintaining them going forward at a standard that we all strive for. One of the other things that this does is that immediately it will qualify 11,743 apartment units for direct federal subsidy. Right now we have, within the 21 city and state developments, They're 20,000 plus units, a couple thousand of which have been converted to Section 8, and therefore they have a funding stream attached to them. But 18,000 of them actually have no funding stream, and that's why you heard us talk about the $90 million of operating costs that we don't receive any support for. That was the 18,000 units that don't have any support. Annually, that costs NYCHA about $90 million that we don't receive from anyone. So getting almost 12,000 of those 18,000 units a funding source is a big, big deal. And it basically equates to between $65 and $75 million a year. Every year from now on, we will receive to support the 21 city and state development. So we wanted $90 million. We didn't quite get all the way there, but we got a long way there in terms of between $65 and $75 million of additional funding. It also, though, the 6,000 units that didn't get the federal funding, we are working with HUD to ensure that they do have a long-term funding stream. And I've had a number of conversations with HUD to give us confidence that they're committed to a full solution for all of these developments, for all of these units, because now that all 21 are in the federal portfolio, we have a real path to ensure that the 6,000 units that don't have funding will also have funding in the next year or two. We know it's going to take us a little time to get there, but HUD is committed to work with us to do it. So we have a plan for all 20,000 plus units in these 21 developments to have funding. And it protects and preserves all of the rights of each and every one of the residents. And that, again, there's no one that will be asked to move out as a result of this. People also want to know that that it's still going to be for low-income residents. And what we can tell you is that not only will all of your tenancy rights be maintained and you're not be asked to move for any reason related to the federalization, but when new units come available in these developments because someone moves out, the actual test on whether they have low-income status actually is going to be tougher than it is today. So going forward, you can't be over 60% of the AMI, the area median income, in order to come into public housing in these developments. So this is actually not only protecting it as low-income housing, but it's actually made the standards around the test even more stringent in terms of people being able to meet that requirement. So we feel very strongly that we've met the commitments that we've put forward. We think that the benefits are clear. It maintains long-term control of these developments by NYCHA, so we're not privatizing. NYCHA is still in control of these developments. It is still public housing, and the public authority that's responsible for ensuring that and the preservation of them will continue to be NYCHA. We will invest $108 million, as I said, from stimulus money, and in addition to the stimulus money, we found a way to leverage that with private and other public money. So in addition to the money that's coming in privately from city community capital, we also were able to get the state to put up $42 million of money for this transaction in modernization money, which was about to expire. And we were able to take cumulative years of modernization money and pull it from the state and put into this opportunity. And that's going into what we're doing as well. So money that wouldn't be available to NYCHA normally is being made available to NYCHA through the federalization transaction. And then ultimately, that money will be used to immediately improve the physical condition of the buildings to ensure that we can comply with HUD's standards. So with that, I'd like to open it up to questions. I know Mr. Spence will come up and take us through that process.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.